back into the early 20s.
When you started out singing and playing the blues?
Well, Ralph, I'm telling you, I've been singing the blues back for all that. This is important. I'm telling you the truth.
What was some of the first blues that you heard, the first blues that you recorded, things you remember from your early days?
Oh, I can, my first number I ever recorded?
Yeah, what was the first one you ever recorded?
Called the Blue Devil Blues with the Blue Devil Orchestra. Uh-huh. It's 27.
1927?
Wow. Yes.
What are some of the other songs from those days that you still remember and play?
Well, back in the old days, here's a tune. Am I to blame for loving you? Not my fault if I do, my poor heart beats with joy. When I'm with you, am I to blame? Skies are blue. Bird is in the tree singing lovesick melody the whole day through. For everyone seems to know that I love my baby so. No one is to blame, baby, but you. So tell me why I always sigh whenever you are by my side. If I keep loving you, am I the blame? Am I the blame for loving you? It's not my fault if I do, my poor heart beats with joy when I'm with you. Am I the blame if skies are blue? Bird is in the trees singing lovesick melody the whole day through. For everyone seems to know that I love my baby so. No one is to blame, baby, but you. So tell me why I always sigh whenever you are by my side. If I keep loving you, baby, am I the blame? Yes, Ralph, it goes back to around Chicago and Kansas City, back into the 20s, cabaret days. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. When you were growing up in Oklahoma City, how did you get interested in the blues?
I had an uncle that used to play the blues, and they were what they call a sporting house, you know?
Uh-huh.
That's forbidden territory for me.
Yeah.
But he had a... Well, he used to play and sing at his place.
Yeah.
And he used to come home at night and bring me, had a hat full of money, wake me up and tell me to stick my hat and get it. And I thought that was the grandest thing in the world. But my father told me he'd kill me if he ever caught me on the place. And matter of fact, I used to go by, used to have to pass the red light district going to school. And you'd see the girls in the window, very pretty. I was eager to get in there. So I finally got up on my nerve one day and knocked on the door. Lady laughed, she said, come in. She said, yes, what can I do for you? I said, I looked around, I see what I thought. I didn't know what I was looking for. But she says, well, what can I do for you? I said, well, nothing, I don't guess. She said, aren't you too young to be in here? I said, I guess I am. So she said, well, what are you looking for? I said, well, I just wanted to look in you. I said, I used to pass you and hear the blues, and it was just killing me because I've always loved blues. And so she said, can you play? I said, yeah. She said, sit down, play a number. And I sat there and played a tune, and everybody came around, sat around, listened to me play. And I guess I was satisfied. If my daddy had passed out, that would have been it.
What did you play for them?
Oh, I went into something like, well, nothing was longer than I was singing blues. I went to blues like this. Catch me stealing, baby, don't you tell on me. If you catch me stealing, baby, please don't tell on me. I'll be stealing back to my old time used to be. And my uncle, of course, he had a blues that, matter of fact, he taught me blues. It went something like this. I don't know where I could play it. This is way back.
Started out the blues, it was sung by Bessie Smith, an influence on you too?
Well, yes, to a certain extent. Matter of fact, I recorded one of Mamie's, well, matter of fact, it was a very big hit in 1921, 22. Mm-hmm. It was a Crazy Blues. Mm-hmm. And now Bessie Smith, she inspired me to a certain extent, but I heard my uncle 1915.
He taught you to play and to sing?
Yes, I said, I'm taught myself, you know. Yeah. Well, my father wanted me to take violin. He bought me a violin, and he forbidden me to touch the piano. So when he'd leave the house, he locked the piano up and give the key to my mother. Yeah. We'd watch for him, seeing he was gone, she'd give me the key. That's what she kept me on. When he'd come back at night, he said, well, get your violin out. I hadn't studied my lesson. Mm-hmm. So I said, all right, let's go. And I wouldn't know anything. He hit me on the fingers. So he said, well, it just finally got to the place where I just couldn't play it. Yeah. So he told me, he said, if I ever catch you on that piano again or dancing again, I'm going to run you away from home. Yeah. Well, I was gone about 2 weeks. But he lived long enough to see my success with Basie. Mm-hmm. And he finally agreed to it, I imagine. He never did say it did, but he always had a smile on his face, you know. He said, well, I guess you're doing okay.
But he didn't even like the Bessie Smith blues?
No, sir. That was honky-tonk music.
All honky-tonk.
Those days they had, they called that honky-tonk. Mm-hmm. And of course, kids, when I was going to school, they loved it. And I used to play piano. And I was the official pianist, you know, for mm-hmm. school drags, we called them, mm-hmm. dances.
Oklahoma City.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I went to Wilberforce University. And that's where I met quite a few great pianists, you know. But my biggest thrill was when I met Jelly Roll Morton.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Where was that?
1923, right in California.
Los Angeles. Were you working out here then?
No, I came out here, incidentally, to Barry. But something happened. I was too young, man. So got out here in California. And I went to work, and I decided to go to a nightclub in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. I went to this nightclub, and Jelly Roll was playing there. And I thought he was the greatest thing I ever heard. And I just went up and made myself acquainted with him. Mm-hmm. And we got to be real chummy. And one night, I was hired to play piano. He played drum. But I was an intermission pianist. Yeah. I asked the fellow for the job. I could only play in 3 keys. Mm-hmm. We had entertainers those days that when they hit the floor, I mean by that, when they come out to go to the tables and sing, I guess the people are robbed of that kind of stuff today. Mm-hmm. When a party came into our nightclub, after they got seated and ordered a drink, why the entertainer go to the table and ask them, or sing, and then ask them if anything else they want to hear. So one night I was playing piano for one of the girls, and I guess she had a cold, and she wanted me to change keys. I played in E-flat, I was swinging, and she says, go to B-flat. I just kept on playing like I didn't hear. And she came back and she called me everything. So Jelly Roll said, that's all right, I'll get him to play for him. And he played, he was a great fella, as far as I'm concerned.
Was there a difference between the blues from New Orleans and the blues from Kansas City?
Well, yes. And Ravis, it sounds funny, but after I sang with New Orleans band, strictly New Orleans band, and I was singing the blues, and I could tell the difference. And the difference is a chord, but I can't tell you the name of the chord.
Yeah.
But where I would sing, like I say, turn down sunshine. See what tomorrow brings. Hurry down, sunshine. See what tomorrow brings. Well, right in there, they would make a different chord. Uh-huh. And they all make that. So I figured that maybe I was wrong. I don't, people stamp New Orleans as the home of the blues, but I don't. Because I found blues during my travel and during the old days where people used to didn't like the blues. I mean, if you played the blues, you were nothing, you know. I mean, but it was a kick to me. It always carried a good feeling. And in the olden days of, if you played the blues, you had to get off to yourself. Just a few people, because guys used to walk around with guitars, you know, and play and sing the blues and mandolins and calls them old stuff. Maybe you don't know anything about it. But that's the way they used to play the blues on the streets and on the corners. Yeah. And the blues tells the story itself because it makes you happy. You can play them, so it gives you a feeling to swing. And here lately, they've gotten to the place where they give it a name, soul music. Mm-hmm. But it has always been a soul music. It always has been soul music.
Well, I've heard you do a blues with a story about tricks.
Oh, yes. You know where that came from? That came from really, I heard my uncle sing it, and that's during the old days, the cabarets, mm-hmm. I mean, the houses. Mm-hmm. You want me to play that for
sure.
you? I'll try it. I told my gal to learn some sense. Stop laying around at Eli Club, getting drunk at my expense. Every dollar and dime she spends has a drop of my blood on it. She runs to me with that same old jive, you know. Daddy, Trix ain't walking no more. What are you talking about, woman? I said, Trix ain't walking no more. You got to be kidding me, man. How we gonna live? Been in my window since the crack of day, trying to make a dollar for our house rent to pay. Oh, there's a landlady. The landlady, she's singing the blues, baby. Just because she can't sell that dirty booze. I've never seen it break so hard for women before. Since Trix ain't walking no more. I know you dig me. It's a shame. It's a dirty shame. It's a dirty, dirty, low-down shame. My gal been gone since the rising of the sun this morning. 40 tricks have passed and she haven't caught one. That's a dirty shame. A dirty shame. That's a dirty, dirty, dirty lowdown shame. Of course, women are weak vessels, men are the blame. Still, if she doesn't catch a trick, it's still a dirty shame. Here she come. Baby, Trix ain't walking no more. What is it? Trix ain't walking no more. No. I've been in my window since the crack of day, trying to make a dollar for our house rent to pay. Baby, got to live some way. Here's the landlady. Landlord is singing the blues just because she can't sell that dirty booze. I've never seen it break so hard for women before since Trix ain't walking no more. I know you dig me. Trix ain't walking no more.
Jimmy, you've always been associated with minds of the public, with Kansas City and Count Basie and the blues. When Basie came to Kansas City, were you playing and singing the blues there then?
Well, I was, when we met Basie, you know, Basie came to the West, Middle West, with a show.
Mm-hmm. Was he a blues piano player?
Huh?
Was he a blues player then?
No. Basie couldn't play the blues. That's funny, sounds funny, but he couldn't. I guess Pete Johnson and all the other, Everett Charles and fellas around Kansas City, very good blues players and singers. And after he got associated with those fellas, he really learned how to play the blues. Basie was an actor on a stage when I first saw him. And they used to ballyhoo, you know what that is?
Mm.
You know what that is? That's about 15 minutes prior to the show, they would take a band. The band would go out in front of the show. They'd play a number, and fellas singing. People would gather around. He would explain the show.
Oh, out in the street?
Yeah. And we used to stand and listen to Basie play. We'd wait till all this ballyhoo would go down so Basie could play.
Yeah.
And he'd start playing. And we'd say, that guy's crazy. And funny thing, when he first heard our band, we were playing on a big truck. We were ballyhooing then. Well, you see, in those days, Ramsey did a lot of ballyhooing.
Uh-huh.
Whatever place you worked for, you had to advertise it yourself. And we used to go out in Ballyhoo, and we were on this truck coming back from playing downtown, you know. So we decided to play blues. They struck up one of those good blues, and the horns playing, and bass here, they thought it was the record.
Yeah.
Somebody told him, said, no, that's the Blue Devil down on the corner playing. Mm-hmm. He ran down then, and that's when he met all the fellows.
Yeah.
Later he quit the show and joined the band.
What kind of blues were you playing then?
Oh, they were playing 8-bar blues and 12-bar blues. Mm-hmm. How long blues is something like, that's an 8-bar blues.
Yeah.
I used to play it, but I don't think I can play it.
You don't think you play it anymore?
How long, baby, how long, baby, how long, how long, how long, have that evening train been gone, how long, baby, how long, baby, how long? Got a gal who lives way up on the hill. If she doesn't love me, I know who will. Baby, how long? Baby, how long? Baby, how long? Heard the whistle blow, I couldn't see no train. Deep down in my heart, I love you again. Baby, how long? Baby, how long? Baby, how long? Got a gal who lives way up on the hill. If she doesn't love me, I know who will. How long? Baby, how long? Baby, how long?
Jimmy, what were the bands that were around Kansas City in those days that you played with and sang with?
Oh, there was Benny Moulton's orchestra. Benny Moulton had the best orchestra around Kansas City for years. He started out with just three pieces.
Uh-huh.
Matter of fact, I remember far back enough, I guess the kids would die now if they had to dance by just piano and drum. 50 cents to go in, yeah. And the hall was packed, 700 people. It's good money, though.
Yes, it is.
And the pianist, he would sing, and the drummer, they'd sing duets together, and they'd play blues and what we call foxtrot, and then a fast one. And
you had singing drummers?
Yes, they had singing drummers, sure.
Who were some of them?
Well, I know a boy by the name of Joe. These fellas never did get to the limelight, you know?
Yeah.
They played a different play. They used to carry, did you ever hear of a human voice whistle?
Yeah.
Well, they used to carry those things and used to shake it like that. It sounded like somebody singing. Ooh, yeah. People think it's somebody singing. They used to keep that. Sometimes that's way they keep very good time. They drummers used to have all those sort of things.
For bands like George E. Lee, were they blues bands too?
Very good blues band. George Lee and Julia Lee was two of the best. That was one of the best teams you've ever heard.
Were the Blue Devils a blues band too?
Noted.
Noted.
And there's Fonda Trent band, they was in Dallas. And there was Troy Floyd's band in Dallas. All those was good bands. People don't, they don't get a chance. Those bands went out of circulation in 30, 31, 32. And in come some new bands, but I was around in 25, 26. And in the earlier, around 24, they used to have 23, they had, today they call them Dixieland Band.
Mm-hmm.
Six, seven pieces, you know.
Mm-hmm.
that was about as large as a band would be. And they played, they furnished you all your music then.
But you began with those bands as a singer.
Yes, I started out trying to play piano. Mm-hmm. After I found out it was pretty hard, couldn't play with three keys. Everything got just got sort of sound alike to me, you know. But I made a living with it. Mm-hmm. And after they told me that I could sing, why, I decided to sing. Mm-hmm. I was working in a, well, I was, during the time that I was told you a few minutes ago, I was working with Jelly Roll in this nightclub. There was a girl blues singer out of Chicago, Carrie Williams, you'd never heard of. Very good. And of course, during intermission, she had to sing suggestive tune, My Baby Rocks Me with a Steady Roll and things like that. And she called on me one night. I like to die.
Did you sing for her?
Yeah. And so she had me to sing, I remember the first song I ever sang. Mm. You gotta see mama every night, you can't see mama at all.
Jimmy, I could talk, listen to you talk and ask you questions for hours, but one final question. Do you think the blues is ever gonna die?
No, they won't. As long as they go like this.
All right. Thank you.